I met Lars Anderson, the next speaker, last spring as he had received a CAPS fellowship to head off to Ethiopia with Water to Thrive. If you don't know it by now, Ethiopia is very central to my life. By the end of this, you will know it and be a little sick of it, maybe. But in any case, Lars is an engineering student. He was a CAPS fellow, as I already mentioned. He has been very central to Engineers Without Borders, which is an organization that is part and parcel of the engineering school, but also has partnered with our nursing school, business school, and education majors. He is a founding member of Brothers Reaching Out, BRO, an international community of Christian men. His presentation is entitled Innovative Spaces in Theory and Practice.
Good morning, everyone. I'm finding this PowerPoint here. I just want to say I'm impressed. I was with Michelle's avoidance of acronyms. I want to apologize on behalf of me and Katie, if anyone's counting. let's see. So what I want to share with you all today is research that I did on what I call innovative space. Innovation is a concept in humanitarianism that is misunderstood in the context of sustainable international development. It is a favorite term for many development organizations for the ideas it evokes. The sources and impact of it are scarcely realized. Louis Bloom and Alexander Betts, researchers from the Refugee Studies Center at the University of Oxford, describe this problem writing, quote, "Although this term innovation has been used to describe new products, project approaches, and systems in international aid, innovation concepts themselves have not been widely unpacked, adapted, or standardized in practice or thinking of humanitarianism." End quote. Improper engagement with innovation can be a devastating inhibitor to sustainable implementation of humanitarian aid, causing humanitarians to blindly accept approaches to development that are simply not applicable to certain contexts. Proper entrance into global humanitarianism requires an understanding of innovative space. In the two worlds of humanitarian innovation, authors Bloom and Betts define two worlds based on notions of top-down and bottom-up innovation. They are distinguished as, quote, "one which falls solely into the institutionalized practice of a small number of humanitarian actors, and which focuses on upwards accountability to donors, and traditionally takes a more top-down approach to implementing solutions and affecting populations, and another which fosters and builds on existing innovative capabilities and systems of local communities," end quote. The former is a more visible and prominent world of humanitarianism. Development organizations are legitimized by their key actors and their transparency and accountability to donors. This formation approaches innovations as approved products that can be implemented and adjusted to in specific contexts. While necessary to the professionalization of the humanitarian sector, research suggests that, quote, "too often evaluation is undertaken simply to satisfy agencies and donors, rather than to improve outcomes for the targeted population," end quote. An understanding of innovation, separate from institutionalized humanitarian work, is necessary to improve relief and development efforts. So the latter world, that of bottom-up humanitarian innovation, is less represented and less understood, and includes partnerships with local NGOs and in-country interaction with beneficiaries. Inseparable from this world are social and cultural considerations. An understanding and assessment of the contextual factors often overlooked by the top-down approach. The nature of this interaction aims to successfully, quote, "draw upon existing innovation that is thriving within affected communities," is a cause for reflection and concern. We can reflect on this through discourse on the concept of participation. As a bottom-up humanitarian innovation strategy, participation has been institutionalized as a core concept for many current organizations, including the International Committee for the Red Cross and the Sphere Project. Defined by Robert Chambers, participation methodologies all frame and facilitate sequences of activities which empower participants to undertake their own appraisal or research and analysis, come to their own conclusions, and take action, end quote. This can be difficult to frame in practice, and the types of success and failure resulting from participatory methodologies are astonishingly undefined. Some methodologies have been very effective at facilitating communal change, yet are criticized for use of public shaming or negative reinforcement. So there's no well-established limit to what participatory methods may do or look like. So a more focused understanding of participation would enable a more appropriate use of it in practice. I offer the notion that participation in international development is at its best a facilitation of knowledge within a community, within an open space, that leads to an innovation of an appropriate solution. In testing this theoretical notion, we ought to consider a few questions. Namely, what do we believe about the capability of innovation within beneficiary communities? And how can our beliefs impact the nature of our interaction, or of the nature of the participatory practice? We must answer these critical questions in humanitarian work we undertake. One way we can encounter the answers lies within the nature of spaces. By this I mean, I refer to the kinds of spaces which exist in any practice of participation, the spaces of which both humanitarians and beneficiaries operate and influence the collective action and results. In the brilliant account titled Making Spaces, Changing Places, Situating Participation and Development, Andrea Cornwall addresses these ideas first by placing space into a political context. Political space is not only something taken up, assumed, or filled, but something that can be created, opened, and reshaped. The notion of policy space evokes sites shaped by through the exercise of agency, in which different actors, knowledges, and interests interact, and in which room can be made for alternatives, but from which some people and ideas remain excluded. End quote. So spaces are not only operated in by participants, but they are generated and maintained by them. This fluidity of spaces indicates that they can compromise the humanitarian ideal of impartiality by excluding ideas and potential participants. As outsider humanitarians, we often first seek consensus within beneficiary communities, hoping to quickly identify beliefs and needs and how to appropriately address them. Cornwall points out that, quote, issues of power and difference may not only undermine the very possibility of equitable consensual decision making, they may also restrict the possibility thinking outside the box. Cornwall offers a simplified question to counter the suppression of bottom-up humanitarian innovation to guide our thought about spaces. Quote, asking who speaks for and about whom would entail looking at more closely at issues of identity, difference, and power, as well as broader issues of accountability and legitimacy. End quote. Spaces may be created and maintained by powerful actors, including self-interested beneficiaries and unfair humanitarians. A similar issue occurs when, quote, spaces fostered as a way of amplifying marginalized voices may end up being filled by gatekeepers who speak for but not with those they represent, end quote. Participants and humanitarians may take this gatekeeper role on behalf of other participants, yet not represent their true beliefs and needs. A critical awareness of influence on these spaces in a specific community enables humanitarians to determine how they ought to facilitate participation. A space in which both beneficiaries and humanitarians engage in the practice of participation helps foster sustainable innovation only insofar as it may be initiated and scaled. Cornwall states that, quote, particular spaces may be produced by the powerful, but filled with those whose alternative visions transform their possibilities, end quote. Thus, if an innovative space is created impartially in the practice of participation, it is continually shaped by the community itself. As Cornwall suggests, quote, sharing the construction of alternative versions of this world can work to fashion networks of solidarity and build people's confidence in their own knowledge and capabilities, and with it, a sense of entitlement shaped by recognition of one's own agency, end quote. This theory may seem idealistic, but its pragmatic potential is seen in a current humanitarian partnership. No plug here. Water to Thrive, a U.S. faith-based nonprofit, quote, dedicated to spreading awareness of the global water crisis while raising the funds necessary to construct water wells for those who desperately need them in rural Africa, end quote, partners with the International Lifeline Fund, and abbreviated as Lifeline, a relief and development organization. Water to Thrive functions as an intermediary between the United States churches and individuals, in particular beneficiary communities, through the full funding of projects. Implementation is performed by these trusted partner organizations like Lifeline. Through a partner organization, quote, each village and well site elects a local water committee who decides on governance of the well, according to Suzanne Wilson, executive director. These partnerships enable Water to Thrive staff and donors to consistently visit project sites. In the words of Suzanne, she sums up the extent of their interaction with beneficiaries. Water to Thrive visits beneficiaries and interacts with them to determine the need and support prior to well construction. Barton Thrive visits the well sites both during construction and upon completion. Interviews are conducted to determine the impact of water on the beneficiaries. Additionally, wells are visited to determine the sustainability and longevity of the projects. Exemplary of this world of top-down humanitarian innovation, Barton Thrive provides the advocacy, professionalization, and accountability valued in global humanitarianism, which enables its partner to occupy and thrive in the world of bottom-up innovation. Lifeline provides direct services to specific areas in East Africa and Haiti. Operating between relief and development, it provides access to clean drinking water and efficient methods of cooking by specializing in, quote, producing freshwater wells and implementing community-led hygiene and sanitation initiatives. So in Uganda, Water to Thrive provides funding for wells in the APAC district. For each project, Lifeline employs participation practices surrounding the areas of water, sanitation, and hygiene, or WASH, within beneficiary communities. John Justin Atai, Lifeline's senior WASH program advisor in the APAC district, oversees the use of a participation method by which community health clubs are established. These clubs organize the members of the community to take initiative for the health of their household and the well-being of others. They supplement water committees and are uniquely composed of, quote, at least 50, but sometimes as many as 150 members, men and women, young and old, and of all levels of education. They similarly are administrated by a, quote, annually elected committee, including chairwoman, vice, secretary, treasurer, etc., who keep all records of members for their household facilities and monitor monthly. John Justin Atai proposes these clubs move through four phases: knowledge, practical, economic, and social. In the first phase, members organize and begin to attend weekly trainings conducted by a community-based facilitator. These sessions catalyze movement into the second phase, in which, quote, members decide on practical ways to improve their homes, motivated by problem-solving activities, end quote. Intended to last at least 6 months, these clubs use song and drama as a way of promoting, quote, learning through fun participatory activities to reinforce good practice, end quote. Post-training, the third and fourth phases reap economic and social improvement through initiatives like communal nutrition, nutrition gardens, and the gain capability and, quote, responsibility for the most vulnerable within their community. Lifeline's use of community health clubs in Uganda epitomizes the creation of innovative space. Open to all and free from interference, they enable a facilitation of knowledge that prompts innovation of appropriate solutions at the household and communal levels. Strategic placement of the community-based facilitator behind, but not in charge, of the club produces the spaces, but allows the alternative visions of members to build solidarity and promote confidence in the possibility of a healthy community. So this is innovative space. So this is innovative space, developed in theory and manifested in practice. So how can we continue to understand and identify this elsewhere? I propose we may do so through examination, realization, and discernment. First, closely and critically examine existing familiar humanitarian efforts. Second, seek to realize the impact our beliefs and interactions have on the capability for bottom-up innovation in beneficiary communities. And finally, discern avenues by which to give our act in ways that enable the creation